All right, good morning, everyone. I think we've got a quorum and we'll go ahead and get started. I'm Steve Burton. I'm one of the faculty members in the Department of Psychiatry at the VA. Welcome to Grand Rounds. And I have the honor this morning of introducing our Grand Rounds speaker, Dr. David Redinger. Before I start, though, let me just also echo the congratulations for those of you who might not have been here for our residency program for their outstanding fundraising with the toy drive, for which they just received an award for the, I guess they raised more funds and more toys than any other of the house staff in the competing departments, and that was very nice, and congratulations to you all. Dr. David Redinger is a fellow faculty member at the VA and a colleague of ours. He works in the substance abuse treatment program. David is a, he grew up in Louisville. He graduated from St. Xavier High School. He obtained a bachelor's degree in economics from the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor, also obtained a bachelor's degree in biology from here at the University of Louisville. From 2006 until 2010, David attended medical school here at U of L. During his time as a medical student here, he was awarded the Spafford Ackerley Award for outstanding performance in psychiatry, which is a very prestigious award that is given by our department. After leaving U of L Medical School, he did his psychiatry residency training in Gainesville at the University of Florida from 2010 until 2014, after which time David returned back to Louisville to do an addiction fellowship in our addictions program here at U of L. And after completing that, this past year, he joined our faculty and our staff at the VA, and we've been glad to have him on board with us. David is a member of the American Psychiatric Association, the American Academy of Addiction Psychiatry, and several other professional organizations. He's received numerous honors and given several scholarly presentations throughout his training. And something of interest about David that I think most people don't know that I'll just share with you. One is that he's an avid competitive chess player. He's also, David has been a master's level competitive swimmer. He's told me that when he was doing that, he was swimming up to 2 miles a day, which is pretty impressive, I think. And he's also a loyal fan of his alma maters at the University of Michigan and the University of Florida Gators. So if there are any Michigan or Florida fans, you don't have to feel. I see at least one in the back of the room back there. So really look forward to David's talk this morning. The title is Competing Risk for Prescribing Buprenorphine. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Redinger.
Welcome, you guys. Thanks for the introduction by Dr. Burton. So on this talk, I want to give in particular because I want to get out there that we need more providers that actually get a waiver and start prescribing buprenorphine. So I wanted to educate everybody on what is involved with that. And another big reason is I do believe there is an actual epidemic out there with heroin use and opiate use, misuse, abuse. For just a couple of statistics, in 2014, more than 14,000 people died from overdose involving prescription opioids. The most common, opioid that was linked to overdoses were methadone, oxycodone, and hydrocodone. And another interesting tidbit in Kentucky, in 2014, Kentucky was one of the five states with the highest rates of death due to drug overdose. So it's a big problem here in Kentucky. And then in 2014, there were 30,000 deaths in the U.S. due to opiates overdose. And opiate overdoses have also quadrupled since the year 2000. So this, I do think it's an epidemic, and as physicians caring for a particular population out there, I think today I want to educate everybody on basically what is involved in prescribing buprenorphine, what the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure recommendations are, and understanding the competing risk for prescribing buprenorphine. In my talk, I want to address basically what evidence-based treatment shows in treating opiate use disorders, what the basically the Board of Medical Licensure requirements are for treating opiate use disorders, what's involved with stabilization and withdrawal, the use of clonidine versus opioid agonist therapy. Clonidine has been used quite significantly in the past 20 to 30 years for treating withdrawal from opiate use disorders. Indications for a medically supervised withdrawal from opiates, also known as detoxification. And then what do you do when a patient is on buprenorphine and also on other scheduled medications, including benzodiazepines and stimulants. And then the addiction-focused medical management model that we want to use when we are treating patients who do require buprenorphine, psychosocial interventions, referral follow-up monitoring, and duration of services. So a lot of the issues that we struggle with these days in treating patients with opiate use disorders is basically the prescribing practices that occur out there today. If you're too conservative in your prescribing practices, you run the risk basically of undertreatment of patients that are in need of treatment. And, you know, patients out there that seek treatment are, you know, if they don't get this treatment, they could possibly have an overdose and die. So that's, you know, the problem of being too conservative in your prescribing practice. However, if you're too liberal and just give everybody buprenorphine, you run the risk basically of misuse and diversion. So it's kind of a battle of finding that sweet spot, balancing risk versus benefits, not only on a micro scale, but also on a macro scale. So what is involved in opiate use disorder treatment? Well, a little bit about what is an opiate use disorder. What qualifies as an opiate use disorder? Well, basically, it's someone who's compulsively seeking to the point where they have drug cravings for illicit drugs, and they use repeatedly over and over again and again, despite harm that occurs in their life. And this could be social, psychological, or physical consequences. That is key in determining if someone does actually have an opiate use disorder. So to treat this opiate use disorder, the pharmacotherapy that is out there as of today is methadone, which is a full agonist at the mu receptor. The mu receptor, of course, is basically in our reward pathway and the nucleus accumbens and throughout the brain that can drive us our enjoyment of things in life. Buprenorphine is also a partial agonist at the mu receptor. Clonidine is an alpha 2 adrenergic agonist. And then there's naltrexone, which is the antagonist at the mu receptor. And then there's also the psychosocial interventions alone. So before I get into anything, I just want to talk a little bit about a patient who comes in need when they are withdrawn from opioids. What type of opioids might they have been using or withdrawing from, and what occurs during that time period? So usually for short-acting opioids like heroin or oxycodone, after their last use, the onset of withdrawal symptoms occurs in 6 to 12 hours. It usually peaks in about 36 to 72 hours and lasts up to 5 days, or can last up to 5 days. Usually the withdrawal from heroin is pretty severe, and they may need inpatient services. And this is what we call a complicated detoxification, as opposed to a non-complicated detox. They could have come in on methadone, and after they stopped using methadone, after their last use, the onset is usually in 36 to 72 hours to start experiencing withdrawal. The withdrawal peaks in about 5 days, can last up to 12 days, And usually the withdrawal that they experience is moderate compared to a heroin withdrawal. And then finally, there's the buprenorphine. If they were chronically on buprenorphine to stop, the withdrawal usually onset in 72 hours, peaks in 7 days, can last up to 15 days, and the withdrawal symptoms they experience are usually mild. The reason why buprenorphine can last up to 15 days is because it has an active metabolite, norbuprenorphine, that stays around for a little bit longer. So what is the evidence out there regarding treatment of these opiate use disorders? There is strong evidence for recommending maintenance agonist treatment, which involves buprenorphine, naloxone, and an office-based opioid therapy, or methadone and an opioid treatment program, which are federally regulated treatment programs. And why is this important? Because without treatment, they've shown that relapse rates can be as high as 90% following just a detoxification with no medication treatment. So keep that relapse rate, 90%, in the back of your mind. There have been several studies out there that shows that buprenorphine has been effective in treating heroin dependence versus just a drug-free treatment. One study in particular by Keiko and Lancet in 2003 showed basically those on maintenance versus just detoxification with clonidine, and they showed the number remaining in treatment versus treatment duration days. After about 100 days or so, basically the people that just got the clonidine detoxification dropped out of treatment, basically. Whereas 15 subjects who were on the maintenance were stayed in treatment. And then in the control group, 4 subjects actually died of an overdose. So it's important, I think, to this study shows that buprenorphine would be important for the treatment of people with these opiate use disorder that are trying to get off of heroin. What are some alternatives to opiate use disorders? Well, people who basically have established abstinence for a sufficient time period of about 2 weeks generally, and opiate agonist therapy is contraindicated, we can use the extended release injectable naltrexone. And moderate quality evidence exists for using the extended release injectable naltrexone. Also alternatives, if they can't use basically either any of the maintenance therapies or the Vivitrol long-acting shot naltrexone, there is insufficient evidence to recommend for or against oral naltrexone for treating opiate use disorders. Why is this important? If a patient refuses these maintenance treatments, maybe that'd be a time period to use motivational interviewing to try to have them reconsider. So I wanted to talk a little bit about bioavailability, also in understanding these medications, understanding affinity at the basically receptor, intrinsic activity at the receptor, rate of dissociation from the receptors. For instance, oral naltrexone only has 10% bioavailability when it's taken orally. The sublingual buprenorphine only has 30% bioavailability, and oral methadone up to 80%. So that is important to note just when you're educating people on how to take buprenorphine. It's important basically to educate them on how to take medication and as in like sublingual versus orally. And so why are we doing this treatment for opiate use disorders? We want to use opiate agonist therapy to prevent withdrawal. We want to use it to reduce cravings. We want to do it to basically reduce the effects due to them using illicit opioids, such as avoiding their risky behaviors when they're caught up in the addictions and And also, we want to help the patient stay on the path of recovery and develop treatment goals. Also, this using buprenorphine and opiate agonist therapy has shown a reduction in exposure to HIV and hepatitis C, because you reduce the amount of dirty needles that are being shared. And also, there are studies out there that show drug-related criminal behavior is decreased. And also because we want to increase the quality of life of these patients. People, we're trying to get these people back to work and establishing a sense of normalcy. I don't know how many times patients have said to me after getting them stabilized on buprenorphine, you know, I'm very thankful. I just, you know, there's a sense of normalcy in my life. I feel like I can cope again. So buprenorphine comes in a mono product and also the combination product, buprenorphine and naloxone. It's a 4-to-1 ratio. Both of them are sublingual tablets, and then the combination product is also a sublingual film. All sublingual forms are not FDA approved for treatment of pain. Other forms of buprenorphine, such as the patch and the buccal film, are approved for chronic pain, but they're not then also approved, FDA approved for treating opiate use disorders. So why is this important? Because a lot of our patients that come to us also have the comorbid pain conditions, chronic and acute pain. But you just have to be very clear in what treatment you're giving and the expectations you have of the patients, and maybe they're more appropriate for either sending to a pain specialist or using methadone. Why? Because methadone is FDA approved for both treating both pain and opiate use disorders, whereas buprenorphine is not. The Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure pretty much says buprenorphine can only be used for medically supervised withdrawal or as maintenance treatment for patients diagnosed with opiate dependence. And they say, well, you can use the transdermal delivery of the buprenorphine monoproduct in the treatment of pain. But once again, you got to make sure that you are, that's part of your scope of practice, basically. If you're a pain management specialist, then yes, you can use the transdermal delivery, but I would not do that if that's outside your scope of practice. So who can prescribe buprenorphine? Basically, anybody with an MD or DO can prescribe buprenorphine after getting what we call a waiver. The point is that by appropriately credentialed physicians in accordance with Data 2000. And what does the Data 2000 say? It was a Drug Addiction Treatment Act of 2000 that came about and was passed in 2002. Basically allowing buprenorphine to be prescribed by anybody with an MD or DO and a special waiver. So what do you need? You need to qualify for the waiver. Of course, you need to have a medical license, DEA, and one of the following must occur. Either your board certified addiction certified from the ASA, or board certified in addiction medicine from the AOA. Or for other MDs, and this includes everybody else, you need a completion of at least 8 hours of training. And in the original Data 2000, they also said if you were participating in an investigator in one of the clinical trials using Schedule 3, 4, or 5, you could also get the waiver, or other training experience considered by the state medical licensing board. And in the original Data 2000, this training could be provided through classroom situations, seminars, at professional society meetings, or electronic communications. It must be sponsored by one of 5 organizations authorized by Data 2000 legislation. The Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure went a little bit further and said you needed personal attendance and completion of a review course approved by American Society of Addiction Medicine. So this caused a lot of issues and concerning that now we're going too far conservative treatment, closing doors on a lot of people, because this makes it a little bit more inconvenient, the fact that now you have to do personal attendance as opposed to just doing an online training. For they also said for each of 3-year continuing education cycle, you must complete at least 12 hours of continuing medical education. And you shall enroll and participate in the Kentucky Health Information Exchange. So it was weird when they came out with the sets of, guidelines and recommendations. It was almost like, you shall do this, you shall, the physician shall. It's like a list of 10 commandments. And it was just like, what? You know, at least that was my initial gut feeling to these requirements by the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure. So what is the Kentucky Health Information Exchange anyway? I have no clue, but I mean, it's a secure and interoperable network that meets national standards to ensure interoperability. So participating providers with certified electronic health record technology can access, locate, and share needed patient health information with other providers at point of care. So this raises an issue with HIPAA compliance, raises issues with difficulty in even signing up for this. I've tried to sign up for it, Dr. Burton has tried to sign up for it, and the VA, doesn't even allow us to participate in the Kentucky Health Information Exchange. So it's kind of curious, you would think maybe the Board of Medical Licensure would have consulted us first before saying that we need to be part of this. Office-based opiate therapy, what is that? So they say for the first year, a physician may only prescribe up to 30 patients. After the first year, they can apply to SAMHSA to raise the treatment limit to up to 100 patients. So why this magic number of 100 patients? I don't think anybody knows really. Random controlled trials have demonstrated the effectiveness of buprenorphine treatment. It's also shown to be very effective for homeless and patients with blood-borne diseases. You know, anybody who prescribes oxycodone or hydrocodone, they don't put a limit on how many per patients per year they can prescribe to. Why with buprenorphine, I'm not sure. Also, opiate agonist therapy, there's 5 systemic reviews that showing that using opiate agonist was effective in both licensed opiate treatment programs, those are the federally regulated ones, as well as within general medical settings. So overall, if the benefits outweigh the potential harms using opiate therapy, you'd want to think, why is there such a restrictive environment out there trying to restrict providers from providing more of this treatment to patients that need it. Also, buprenorphine was compared to methadone. Meta-analysis of studies comparing both buprenorphine and methadone are equivalent in terms of suppressing illicit opiate use, but it did show that methadone had slightly better treatment retention. There's also high quality evidence that buprenorphine is more effective than oral naltrexone or placebo therapy in improving opiate consumption and time to relapse. Moderate evidence also supports higher versus lower dosing of buprenorphine for improving treatment retention. So I'm kind of like pushing buprenorphine, right? I just wanted to say I have no disclosures. You know, buprenorphine is not paying it for any of this or anything like that. I just think it's a valid treatment that should be out there that every provider actually consider giving as a possibility as a good treatment for their patients. And anybody with an MD or DO can do this. So what are some adverse effects? Sedation, headache, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, constipation, and withdrawal syndrome. At high doses, buprenorphine's agonist effects plateau due to the ceiling effect, limiting the maximum analgesic and respiratory depression effects. So why is this important? This is important because it's very hard to overdose on buprenorphine if you are a healthy patient and you have not mixed anything else with buprenorphine, like other agents like sedatives. So due to the ceiling effect, it's a very safe medication. And there you have it. Why is buprenorphine have this quality about it? Because it's a partial agonist. So the higher the dosage, basically it levels off, and the percentage of mu receptor intrinsic activity, it actually starts acting a little bit as like an antagonist at higher medication dosages. Whereas heroin keeps on going and eventually will lead to an overdose and possible death. There are some clinically significant drug interactions. So if you're treating with HIV, it can increase Those medications, as tenofovir and ritonavir, can increase buprenorphine concentrations. And if someone's on rifampin, this can decrease buprenorphine concentrations. And that, you got to watch them, because they could develop an opiate withdrawal. And also, when you start someone on buprenorphine, that when I initially showed how many hours you have to wait before, when someone is either taken off methadone or taken off heroin, it's important, because you could send someone into precipitate withdrawal. And that's one thing you want to avoid. So that's why they say wait until someone you see withdrawal symptoms first before giving someone buprenorphine. And why is this happening? Because buprenorphine has one of the highest affinities for the mu receptor of all opiates out there. And also, it can cause precipitate withdrawal because it's a partial agonist, right? So there's a net loss of receptor activity at the receptor. Another thing I wanted to talk about is, well, how long should you have someone on buprenorphine? Should you have them on for a year, 5 years, 10 years, you know, 2 weeks? There is evidence out there that buprenorphine maintenance is better than actually just a buprenorphine taper. There was a study that showed that supporting buprenorphine for maintenance 14 weeks over a taper for improving treatment retention. If taper is chosen, so if you do use buprenorphine or methadone to taper someone off of either, you know, heroin or, you know, Oxycontin, they recommend, there's evidence to recommend trying to get them on an Vivitrol shot, which is the long-acting naltrexone. And that's 380 milligrams a month, so it lasts a month. The Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure says you want a dose to make sure you don't cause opioid sedation. When you're dosing buprenorphine, you also want to minimize, of course, the craving, the opiate withdrawal. And you only want to use this once daily. Now, that's important because a lot of patients come in want to take it more than once daily. Why? Because the analgesic effects of buprenorphine only last 6 hours. And a lot of times they're also trying to treat their pain, so they'll want to take it more often than once daily. And then once you do stabilize people on buprenorphine, you only can give a maximum of basically a supply of 1 month's worth. Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure says if there's non-compliance with the treatment plan, for instance, missing appointments, abnormal Casper, abnormal urine drug screens, then you need to adjust the way you treat the patient. And here are some ways of adjusting that treatment. Your goal should be to use maintenance therapy for people with severe opiate use disorders. If you can't do that, then there is strong evidence for using a tapering schedule, using either methadone, but remember, of course, this is in a federally regulated opiate treatment program, so not too many patients have access to that. And then you can use buprenorphine, and all you need for that is the waiver. And then if you can't use the taper, if you can't use the maintenance, then there is strong evidence to using clonidine to help them get through the withdrawal symptoms. And when you're assessing someone with, and you're trying to stabilize them, getting through them with withdrawal, there is evidence suggesting that we should be using COWS. It's a clinical opiate withdrawal scale. There are no random control trials comparing using it to assess withdrawal symptoms. And it was developed by Weston and Ling, actually, for treatment with buprenorphine. And what does the COWS score assess? Basically assesses these following symptoms which patients experience when they're going through withdrawal. As you can see, the rating system there. But they have shown evidence, if you do use the clinical opiate withdrawal scale, that there is showing shortening length of hospital stays, reducing the amount of maybe sedative medications that needed to be used, and averting unnecessary hospitalization. So with the induction phase of buprenorphine, usually lasts 2 to 3 days, and the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure wants us to use COWS. And it says in their guidelines that absence must be, I guess it must have been going through withdrawal prior to first buprenorphine dose. And this dose can be 2 or 4 milligrams. So usually you want to see a cow's score of 8 to 10 before first dose. Basically, you want to wait 16 hours after last use of a short-acting opioid, 24 hours for a sustained release opioid medication, and 36 hours for methadone. So what is clonidine? Why has it been used for, you know, for 20 plus years in treating withdrawal symptoms from opioid use disorders? Because they found that it treats anxiety, restlessness, and insomnia that comes with the opioid withdrawal. Because when you're going through withdrawal, basically there's a hyperactivity of the noradrenergic neurons in the locus coeruleus, and that causes increased blood pressure, heart rate, respirations, increased sweating, and diarrhea. What's good about methadone and buprenorphine, this is why they suggest you should use this instead, is because not only does it treat the sympathetic nervous system response when patients are going through withdrawal, it also reverses the increased GABA effects due to reduced dopamine and nicotinamide that the patient will experience as dysphoria, depression, and cravings, in particular cravings. Because cravings is what a lot of times I will base on how to dose buprenorphine once they get in the stabilization phase. Reducing cravings will help them stay in recovery because then they won't obsess continuously about wanting to get the next illicit fix. If using clonidine, if you have to use clonidine, adjuvant medication should also go along with that since it only deals with the sympathetic part of the withdrawal. For instance, you can use dicyclamine, promethazine, loperamide, baclofen, and acetaminophen and ibuprofen to treat the other withdrawal symptoms that they may be experiencing. So, once again, I'm going to reiterate, unstable opioid use disorders, there's strong evidence against withdrawal management with just clonidine. Due to why? Because afterwards, once they leave, you know, the detoxification process, there's a high risk of relapse and overdose, up to 90%. So therefore, administration of long-term opiate agonists are generally preferred, also over even tapers of using just buprenorphine and methadone for the tapers and detoxification protocols. Not only this, but opiate agonist therapy has been shown to be safer than other pharmacotherapies, including clonidine over time. And they have been shown to be found to be more effective than clonidine. And there's no evidence to support addition of course clonidine once you have them on a regimen of buprenorphine or methadone. So clonidine is considered a second line agent. And the success rate for clonidine in the outpatient arena is even lower. There's a study done basically with Ling in 2005. This should be 13 days, not 13 weeks. Showing basically they had an inpatient detoxification arm and an outpatient detoxification arm, and comparing Suboxone with clonidine, and after 13 days, 77% of the patients were drug-free, as opposed to 22% who did the clonidine taper. And then in outpatient results were significantly lower, but still it showed a significant difference between clonidine and buprenorphine. And, you know, there are some adverse effects of clonidine. It's a medication that was originally developed to treat hypertension, so it can cause a decrease in systolic and diastolic blood pressure, result in dizziness. And as we learned in medical school, if you have someone consistently on clonidine, there can be, and you cut them off of clonidine, all of a sudden they can have a rebound hypertension. So extra precaution should be exercised in patients older than 50 to this risk of dizziness and falling. And clonidine has been associated also with dysphoria. So if you're going to do a medically supervised withdrawal, like detoxification, once again, you should probably use buprenorphine or methadone as opposed to clonidine. However, this use of these substances are less successful in achieving the long-term goal of reducing opiate use. So if you, the goal should always be to put them on maintenance. And also, when you have someone on a maintenance schedule, there's the secondary measures, and there are medical, legal, and social consequences, and getting them and keeping them in recovery. And then also, you ultimately want to avoid death from overdose. But there's even statistics on using, if methadone is used for taper, as opposed to the 90% relapse, only 82% relapse within 12 months, and 45% relapse within 3 months. So that's a little bit better than 90%. There's evidence out there that buprenorphine taper, if you're gonna use buprenorphine to taper, there's no difference between going 1 week or 4 weeks. And when they were measuring opiate negative urines. And if you just talk to addicts, I guess they prefer buprenorphine over methadone and over clonidine. So when should you use a tapering schedule as opposed to maintenance? Basically, if a patient is entering an environment that requires abstinence, like prison, or if the patient, remember, this is all based upon patient preference. It's always, you always gotta keep that in the back of your mind. Whatever the patient wants is ultimately what you should, that's the treatment you should provide them with. If their physical, I guess, opiate dependence is very mild, you don't necessarily need to jump to using buprenorphine or methadone. And also they could be in a profession that requires them to be on no opioid agonists, like healthcare provider. A little bit on when should you use the mono product versus using the combination product. The Kentucky Board of Medical Legislature says you should use mono product in a pregnant patient. So if you're treating that population who are, I guess, childbearing, you should always get a pregnancy test to make sure they're not pregnant before using the combination product, because then you want to use the mono product. Or a patient that has demonstrated hypersensitivity to naloxone. So the Kentucky Board of Medical Legislature says anybody that's using buprenorphine and other substances like benzos or stimulants, you need to consult with either a psychiatrist, addiction specialist, unless you're in an emergency situation, then you can provide them with a 30-day period of both medications. But they're pretty strict about that. And once again, that kind of like binds us from treating patient on an individual basis when they have these blanket guidelines out there. They also have recommendations if a patient is transferred from another provider. Basically, you want to put them back on the established dose that they were on from the previous treatment provider, but make sure you do the necessary documentation. If the patient is, what do you do with the patient that is in withdrawal, has gone through all that, but they haven't relapsed yet? So there's no, making sure, oh, they're having withdrawal symptoms. They just show up and are interested in wanting to get on buprenorphine. Well, you want to do some investigations, of course, and everybody who is on buprenorphine, or you're going to decide to do an induction with them, you run on a CASPER report. That's a requirement. But, of course, you don't have to wait until they have withdrawal symptoms. You just would start the induction. But you might want to start off at 2 milligrams as opposed to 4. And so when should you refer to specialty clinics if you're a general practitioner? Well, if you seem, if your patient seems might benefit from an additional evaluation of their substance use problem, if they have a complicated opiate use disorder that you're not comfortable with, and also if they seek out specialty care, if they want that. And of course, this should be left up to the clinical judgment of every provider. So in the what we like to use in our practice is what I like to refer to as the addiction focused medical management. So it's a little bit more stringent monitoring process and follow-up with these particular population of patients. We use laboratory markers, and we also, of course, go through extensively with them a buprenorphine treatment agreement between us and the patient. And if they violate any of those treatment stipulations, there would be consequences. So we're careful to monitor their adherence, response to treatment, and adverse effects. And education is a big part of this. And we also have basically built in our practices them to either attend self-help groups such as AA or NA, or they must, and depends on the patient, also seek individual therapy with a substance use disorder therapist at least once every 4 weeks. Now, the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure says when you first start someone on Suboxone, basically no later than 10 days after induction, and then at intervals no more than 10 days for the first month after induction. So there's a process with starting someone on Suboxone. There's the induction phase, then the stabilization phase, and then basically the maintenance phase. And then in the second month, you're supposed to see them at intervals no more than 14 days apart. And then finally, once they get that maintenance phase, you can see them once a month. So, and if you use the addiction-focused medical management model and you have a pretty stable patient, several studies have shown that adding more addiction-specific counseling really provides no benefit compared with just using careful monitoring techniques. There's been several studies that have shown that there's no evidence about benefit for addition of 12 weekly individual CBT sessions, and little benefit was obtained when adding behavioral treatment to outpatient-based opiate treatment. However, if you have a complicated patient, we still recommend seeking that, additional substance use disorder therapist. So part of the addiction-focused medical management model is you want to meet the patient where they're at, using motivational interviewing and a shared decision-making approach. And as you can see, the federal regulations on providing ancillary counseling services say a physician must have the capacity to refer the patients for appropriate ancillary services, stating basically leaving it up to you. However, the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure goes a little bit further, says that physicians shall implement a treatment plan that requires participation in a behavior modification program, which may include counseling or 12-step facilitation. So, I don't know. For patients with opiate use disorders, for whom opiate use disorder pharmacotherapy is contraindicated, there's been insufficient evidence to support for or against psychosocial interventions alone. Where are these? What are we talking about? Well, I guess there's risk with all treatments, and so we got to remember even there's risk with group of mutual help involvement. It can be sometimes counter-therapeutic, especially with patients with PTSD or social anxiety disorder are particularly vulnerable. So just take that all into consideration. You're always weighing the risks versus benefits. What do we mean by mutual health groups? We're talking about 12-step facilitation, so obtaining a sponsor is big. Peer language, focused on increasing attendance to 12-step, like NA or AA. There's network support, they stress making new sober friends to make abstinence more reinforcing. And of course, patient values and preferences should always be considered. What do we do with follow-up? Follow-up should always be periodical and systemically, using standardized and valid instruments, of course. And we're always ongoing, evaluating the patient for their cravings, side effects. And other patient needs are important to address, too. I mean, we might always want to do a full assessment with all these patients. So the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure says after 3 months of initiation, you should determine and document whether the patient's dosage should be continued or modified. Then every 12 months, you're supposed to evaluate for and document the medical necessity for continued treatment at your established dose. Monitoring, so when you're monitoring a patient, you want to identify barriers. And there's a lot of barriers out there to treating opioid use disorders. And so some of these treatment modalities out there that are available today because of our new technologies are telehealth. There's a big push for that, of course. But while you're treating the patient, always, you know, maybe come up with milestones during treatment, just like we have milestones that need to be reached by residents here. You can do the same thing with your patients. And then always, you know, looking at your urine drug screens, laboratory values. And a lot of my patients, and you kind of get the sense when they've got this thing licked or no one will know. I notice, kind of get this feeling in your gut that, oh no, this might be time trigger for a relapse with them. So I just wanted to kind of give you guys that bit of advice. And then that's when you might need to have a change of intensity of your care. The Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure says you must have at least 8 drug screens from the patient within each 12-month period of treatment. At least 2 of the drug screens shall be random. The 2 random ones shall be coupled with pill count. And then what happens if your patient shows up and says, oh, I lost my medication, I don't know what happened to it. You can't just automatically give them a replacement. The Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure wants you to actually advise the patient to report the loss or stolen medications to police or LEA to minimize diversion. So what's evidence in regards to ongoing support? So how long should these patients be in rehab? Should, you know, 30 days work, 60 days, 90 days? Actually, according to the National Institute of Drug Abuse, retaining patients for longer treatment durations, particularly 90 days or more, is more likely to lead to successful outcomes. However, then a meta-analysis of 19 controlled studies found that continuing care had a small but significant positive effect on substance use outcomes. Then there was a study by Blodgett in 2014, meta-analysis that did not find that continuing care effects varied by intervention, duration, intensity, modality, or setting. So there's kind of conflicting evidence on this. What about relapse during treatment? Like if someone's in a 30-day, average 30-day program or at SARP, should we automatically discharge them if they relapse while they're in the program? Evidence shows that we should not do that. So this is kind of more harm reduction model. Instead, they suggest you should consider modifying treatments by either increasing the intensity of care or the direct opposite, decreasing the intensity. Maybe, residential is not appropriate at this time. So this is the, of course, the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure. Kind of say, if you violate any of their stipulations, this could happen to you. And the whole point of this lecture basically is to educate you guys so we can get more prescribers out there for buprenorphine, but also, you know, sometimes the regulatory agencies are too constricting on us and cause us to be very conservative in our prescribing practices, leading to risk of undertreatment of patients and saving lives, preventing overdoses. That is the conclusion of my talk. Any questions? Yes. I agree, you're preaching to the prior, to the choir. Yep. Yep. Yeah, I completely agree with that, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to give this presentation, just to get it out there, get people talking about it, educate people about it, because, I mean, we do have an epidemic right now that, you know, and we need to get more providers out there willing to prescribe buprenorphine. Yeah, it's a very difficult road. Yeah, you have to have a lot of patience for sure. Ancillary services, because these patients often do have complicated lives and their addiction is very complicated, would be important. Yes, I mean I didn't mean to say that you as a provider can handle everything. I do think therapy is important, but I just didn't like how I guess the Kentucky Medical Association was like, you have to have, I think that should be left up to the provider to make that decision.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, indeed.
How do you reconcile that finding that there wasn't any difference between providing the active therapy alone and then the comprehensive with it?
Which one? Oh, I think that what I'm trying to stress there is that the psychiatrist, yes, complicated patient that you're dealing with, if you have a good model and you're using good therapy techniques yourself with the patient, oftentimes in addition to all of that, like another therapist on top of that is not beneficial, or at least that's what the evidence shows. What does that mean, right? But that's what random controlled trials have demonstrated, that the more you throw at a patient, more therapy doesn't necessarily benefit just having you and the patient, meeting their needs when they need to be met.
Outpatient clinic where there's that meets the
That's what the studies show. However, the Kentucky Board of Medical Licensure says that no, you do need to have ancillary services. And you can't just see you as a provider. You also have to have them set up, seen either AANA with a sponsor, or they have to be seen like a substance use disorder therapist. And I guess my point is, you know, why have a blanket rule like that? Why not leave that up to the provider, which it should be left up to? No, so far it's still 100. Back, what I think, Dr. Casey? Yes, unfortunately, yes. Well, we should use science, though, to help our patients' lives. You know, not morality, but... Splitting hair in what way? Well, they're no longer sharing dirty needles. They're getting back to work. They have a sense of normalcy about their lives. You know, they're not spreading HIV, you know, hepatitis C. You know, there are things out there that when they're in this treatment that are benefits. And the benefits is shown to outweigh the harms. Whereas someone is just on heroin, a lot of things can go wrong there, including overdose and death. Yes, that's an issue that I often come up against. No, I think there people are getting treated outside the VA system. I can tell you there's around 500 buprenorphine providers in the state of Kentucky right now. I think around like 350 of them can prescribe up to 100 patients, or and there's 120 that can only prescribe up to 30 patients because that's they're just starting out. So we are getting more and more providers out there to just prescribe buprenorphine. It's just I wanted to stress that we need even more than that. Well, it's like with all treatments, you know, it's hopefully insurance will cover it. Yeah. Methadone is cheaper. If they didn't have insurance covering anything, the methadone treatment would be cheaper. I think it's like for a week, it's $114. Whereas the last I looked, the 4 milligram buprenorphine tablet was something like $2.30, whereas the actual Suboxone tablet was twice as much. Well, it's interesting. Every state is different. Like where I did my training and residency, University of Florida and the state of Florida, they actually had something called the Marshall Act, which was involuntary hospitalization for anybody underneath or due to a substance use disorder, as opposed to involuntary hospitalization due to, you know, a mental health disorder. My experience was the actual involuntary hospitalization had some teeth to it for mental health disorders. Like a judge would say, okay, yes, I support you guys. With the Marshall Act, rarely could you find a judge that would be willing to sign up and support that. So it didn't have any teeth backing to it. I'm not sure. Okay.
Right.
I concur, yeah. Documentation. Any other questions? Oh, right there. I do that on an individual basis. I mean, maybe a year or two. Yeah, 82%. Yes, their support systems are extremely important. Absolutely. Thank you, guys.
Yeah.